Hello everyone, welcome back. So today we are going to be discussing the questions that were asked in the JIPMER June 2020 exam regarding microbiology. Right, now before we start our session, let me remind you that don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel PGME Microbiology Prep. For any queries, you can contact me on my email address micro.queries@yahoo.com. For academic discussions, you can join my Facebook group Microbiology Prep by Dr. Shivika. And for complete videos of medical microbiology, kindly subscribe to the Marrow app. So let's get started. We have a whole lot of questions to discuss today. Which of the following regarding dermatophyte infections is correct? The first option says zoophilic dermatophytosis lesions are refractory to treatment. Zoophilic dermatophytosis is associated with mild infection. Anthropophilic dermatophytosis readily respond to treatment. And anthropophilic dermatophytosis is associated with a chronic course. Okay, now as you all must be knowing that dermatophytes are categorized according to the reservoir into anthropophilic, geophilic and zoophilic, right? Now what we have to remember is that the geophilic and the zoophilic dermatophytes, their lesions present acutely, so there will be lots and lots of inflammation and they show a very good response to treatment. And recurrences are rare, okay, right? So coming to anthropophilic dermatophytes, the lesions are chronic, but they are mild and innocuous. Remember, the one which is human to human transmitted, humans are the reservoirs, the anthropophilic ones, they have a chronic course, a mild appearance, but they show poor response, so in the sense that they require more treatment and recurrences are common. Moving on to our next question, the MIC is determined by all of the following tests except the epsilometer test, in short written as the E-test, agar dilution method, microbroth dilution method and the disc diffusion test. Now, MIC can be determined by all of these methods except for the disc diffusion method, okay? In the disc diffusion, this is a qualitative test. It just tells us whether the bacterium is sensitive or resistant to that particular antibiotic, okay? So the answer here is disc diffusion. You cannot determine the MIC. Look at this diagram here. That's our disc diffusion. What we did, we took the agar culture plate, the Muller-Hinton agar, and the standard inoculum of the test bacterium is swab inoculated over this Petri plate. Then we placed those antibiotic discs which were containing a single standardized concentration of antibiotic. And after overnight incubation, we saw zones of inhibition around the antibiotic discs. Depending upon the diameter of the zone of inhibition, we will say it is sensitive or resistant to that particular antibiotic. You cannot determine the minimum inhibitory concentration with the disc diffusion method. I'm sure you all remember what is the name of the disc diffusion method. It is the Kirby-Bohr disc diffusion method. This is how we do the dilution method, the broth dilution, in which we have prepared serial dilutions of antibiotic in the Muller-Hinton broth medium and we've added the standard inoculum to each of these dilutions. And what was the minimum inhibitory concentration? The lowest concentration of the antibiotic which just inhibits the growth of the bacterium, right? For example, in this case, it would be 0.5 micrograms per ml, okay? So that is how we do the dilution method. We could do it either on an agar medium or in a broth medium. And this is a diagram of the epsilometer test, in which instead of discs, what do we have? We have special plastic strips and these are impregnated with a graded concentration of antibiotic. Right, after swab inoculating our Muller-Hinton agar plate with a test organism, we will place this antibiotic strip. And we will get this kind of ellipsoidal zone of inhibition, and where this zone of inhibition intersects this plastic strip, that concentration of antibiotic, we will say, this is the minimum inhibitory concentration, right? So the disc diffusion method, you cannot determine the MIC. Next question, assay of which of the following is useful for the diagnosis of invasive aspergillosis? Right now, when we talk about diagnosis of invasive aspergillosis, one diagnostic technique is do a biopsy of whatever the site of infection. Generally, it is the lung. Lung biopsy, that is what we get in invasive aspergillosis, right? And what do we see in that? Hyaline, septate, hyphae, which are typically showing the dichotomous branching or acute tangled branching. But we can also detect certain antigens in the patient's serum. What are these antigens? One is galactomannan and the other is beta-1,3-D-glucan. Both these antigens can be detected by ELISA, and it can suggest invasive aspergillosis. Okay, but remember that beta-1,3-D-glucan antigen is also detectable in other invasive diseases like systemic candidiasis, pneumocystis, pneumonia, right? So, but this one is specific for invasive aspergillosis. Moving on to our next question. The Vibrio species, which is lactose fermenting and can cause septicemia. Now, generally, when we talk about Vibrios, we call them as late lactose fermenters, right? So, basically, what do we call Vibrios? Actually, we call them as non-lactose fermenter, because after overnight incubation on the McConkie medium, we are going to see pale colored colonies. But if we incubate this metriplate for a couple of days more, then we will see that they will become late lactose fermenters. But there's one species which is lactose fermenting after overnight incubation, and that is Vibrio vulnificus. That is why we also call it as the L plus Vibrio. And this has the ability to cause septicemia, especially in people who have iron overload states, right? And immunodeficient patients, it can cause septicemia. Right, so our answer to this question is Vibrio vulnificus. Which of the following is the non-fluorescent dye amongst the following, right? GEMSA, calcofluor white, oramine O, acridine orange. That's pretty easy. GEMSA is a non-fluorescent dye. Calcofluor white has a fluorescent dye that binds to chitin in the fungal cell walls. Oramine O binds to mycolic acids in the cell wall of mycobacteria. Acridine orange can bind to single-stranded or double-stranded DNA, right? All these are fluorescent dyes. Other examples of fluorescent dyes, rhodamine O, lysamine rhodamine, fluorescein isothiocyanate, all these are fluorescent dyes. Which of the following is not associated with a rash? Not associated with a rash, and we have all rickettsiaceae members written out here. Whenever I teach rickettsia, I always talk about the fact that the exceptions are the most important. Which of them is not arthropod transmitted? Which of them does not parasitize endothelial cells? And which of them is not associated with a rash? And what are we going to answer? The answer is Q fever. Q fever has no rash in any form, acute stage or chronic stage. A 6-year-old child has fever for the last 7 days and sore throat for the last 2 days. So fever with sore throat. On examination, she has a whitish vesicle with red areola in oropharyngeal mucosa. What is the likely diagnosis? So this is a 6-year-old child with a vesicular eruption in the mouth with sore throat. So what is your diagnosis? Amongst this, let's read the options first. Hand-foot-mouth disease. Why is hand-foot-mouth disease not the answer? Because in that, even the vesicles will be present on the palms and the soles, right? though these are not mentioned. Herpangina, yes, that could be the answer. Herpangina is also called as vesicular pharyngitis. It is caused by primarily Coxsackie A viruses. Infectious mononucleosis has no vesicular eruption. Herpes zoster virus, there's no other, you know, the exanthem on the skin. So we will rule out herpes zoster because no other kind of rash is mentioned, skin rash, right? So the answer here will be herpangina, that's caused by Coxsackie A. All are inherently resistant to colistin. Now, this is a tough question. All bacteria are inherently resistant to colistin except Burkholderia, Stenotrophomonas, Serratia, and Proteus. The answer to this is Stenotrophomonas. This is sensitive to colistin. Now, when we talk of colistin, we know it's a cyclic cationic polypeptide. That is its structure, cyclic cationic polypeptide. And we have two polymyxins, polymyxin B and polymyxin E. We know it more often as colistin, right? These are polypeptides. Polymyxin B is derived from Bacillus polymyxa and colistin is derived from Bacillus colistinus. Now remember that both these polymyxins are active against the gram-negative aerobic bacteria, against the gram-negative bacilli, in fact, which are aerobic, except these ones. Proteus, that was amongst the options, then Providentia and Morganella. All these three, remember, they are members of Enterobacteriaceae. They are closely related to each other. They give the phenyl pyruvic acid test positive. Then two other members of Enterobacteriaceae are also resistant. These are Serratia and Edwardsiella, right? So these are the five members of Enterobacteriaceae resistant. So Proteus was mentioned in the question. Serratia was mentioned in the question. Then apart from this, Helicobacter and Campylobacter, they are also resistant. Moraxella, Brucella, Burkholderia, so even Burkholderia was mentioned. These are resistant. Vibrio and Aeromonas are also resistant, right? So these are the gram-negative bacilli which are aerobic and they are resistant to polymyxins. What are we also going to remember? That all gram-positive bacteria, all gram-negative cocci and most gram-negative, the most anaerobes, they are all resistant to the polymyxins, right? So remember, polymyxins, they are mainly active against gram-negative aerobic bacilli with these exceptions. So the answer to this question was Stenotrophomonas. Which of the following is transmitted by mites? Now that's a very, very easy question. Scrub typhus is a favorite of all examiners. In every exam, almost every other exam, scrub typhus is asked. So scrub typhus, it is transmitted by the shiggers, that is the larvae of trombiculate mites. Larvae of trombiculate mites. Right? Epidemic typhus is louse transmitted. Q fever has no role of arthropods. Rocky Mountain spotted fever is transmitted by hard ticks. Right. Preformed toxins are implicated in all except. Right. So the answer to this, whenever I talk about preformed toxin causing disease, always remember three of them. One, foodborne botulism, then staph food poisoning and Bacillus cereus emetic type, right? All these are associated with preformed toxins, right? Foodborne, remember what was the food? Home preserved or industrialized canned food. Staph food poisoning, these are heat stable preformed toxins in various kinds of foods. Bacillus cereus, what is the food? The Chinese or the fried rice with preformed emetic toxin. So the answer to this is Vibrio cholerae. The cholera toxin is produced in the GI tract. A farmer with Middle East origin. Remember, whenever you have some person, the patient originating from a particular area, that has been written for a particular reason over there, right? So Middle East origin presents with low back ache and left hip pain, right? So low back ache with left hip pain. So this is arthritis. This could be osteomyelitis of the lumbar vertebrae, along with severe weight loss, anorexia. What is this? This is Mediterranean fever. This is chronic brucellosis. Chronic brucellosis presenting as lumbar vertebrae osteomyelitis, arthritis of the hip joint, and severe weight loss. Which of the following will you use for the treatment? So the answer, the best treatment for brucellosis is give streptomycin for 2 to 3 weeks intramuscularly along with doxycycline orally for 6 weeks. That's our best treatment, right? This is what is recommended. Look at this table that I've made. When we talk about brucellosis, as I mentioned just now, the best treatment is doxy with streptomycin. What are the alternatives that we can give? Doxycycline to be given for 6 weeks along with gentamicin for 1 week. This is the one alternative. So streptomycin replaced with genta, or we can use doxycycline plus rifampicin for 6 weeks, right? This is the other alternative, right? So doxy plus genta, doxy plus rifampicin, these are alternatives. Coming to neurobrucellosis, here we are going to give ceftriaxone for 1 month and combine it with doxycycline plus rifampicin for 4 to 5 months. So if the patient has meningitis, think of giving 3 drugs together, doxy plus rifampi plus ceftriaxone, right? Which of the following is not an AIDS-defining illness? Kaposi sarcoma, it is. Primary lymphoma of the brain, yes it is. Invasive carcinoma of the ovary, this is not one of the AIDS defining illnesses. And invasive carcinoma of the cervix, right? So the answer is carcinoma of the ovary. Which of the following cannot cause a primary lung abscess? Options: Peptostreptococcus, Bacteroides, Pseudomonas, and Prevotella. The answer to this is Pseudomonas. Basically, in medicine, you must have been taught that lung abscesses are broadly categorized into primary and secondary. What is a primary lung abscess? This is that which follows the aspiration of either oral or gastric contents, right? So in this, remember, primary lung abscess is primarily caused by flora which are present in the mouth. Pseudomonas is never a normal flora in healthy humans, right? It's a normal flora only in a few people like cystic fibrosis. So Pseudomonas will never cause a primary lung abscess. So it will cause mainly oral flora. What are the normal oral flora? So many anaerobes like Prevotella, Bacteroides, Fusobacterium, Streptococci, Peptostreptococci, all these cause a primary lung abscess. Why? Because that is that which follows the aspiration of contents. And 80% of lung abscesses are primary lung abscesses. Okay. And the other type of abscess is secondary, and that usually follows underlying lung disease, an underlying disease which is causing some form of airway obstruction, like an intrinsic thing, something like a tumor, or an extrinsic thing like a foreign body, right? So secondary lung abscess follow an underlying disease which is causing airway obstruction, or there is some immunosuppression in the patient. And we have a huge category. What we have to remember is the one, this one was asked, primary lung abscess mainly caused by normal overflow. Regarding species of Canada, which of the following can cause hospital outbreaks and epidemics? Now, the options here are Vishwanathae, Cruziae, Albicans, and we have our culprit species, Candida auris. I had put this up, this snippet in my Facebook group last year in April when it came out. It was being, this Candida auris is being reported to cause outbreaks and epidemics in almost, now it is in, reported in five continents. All five continents have reported Candida auris outbreaks. Right, so that's our answer to this question. It has been reported from all five continents in the form of nosocomial infections. What is the biggest problem about Candida auris is the fact that it is highly resistant to antifungals. That's the biggest issue. Patient who developed nosocomial fungemia due to Candida auris, it is very, very difficult to treat them. Then we got another question on Candida auris. Incorrect statement about Candida auris. It can resist 1% of chlorhexidine, can grow at 42. Identification is difficult. It can grow in 10% of salt concentration. The incorrect statement is 1% of chlorhexidine, right? It can easily be destroyed by using 1% of chlorhexidine. Now, let me just talk briefly about Candida auris. There are two species of Candida which can be present, like if they present on the, they are present on the skin as normal flora. These two species are Candida auris, and the other species is Candida parapsilosis. This question was asked sometime back, about 3 years back also, in Jipmer. Which of the following is transmitted in hospitals from skin to skin transmission? The answer was parapsilosis, right? Both these species are, you know, when the skin falls, these small skin flakes, they, you know, they keep getting transmitted here and there. And that's how other people also, immunodeficient patients also get infected with Candida auris and parapsilosis in the hospital, right? So remember them as skin flora. Can persist on the skin as well on inanimate objects like plastic or non-porous surfaces for several, for months together. So skin as well as can persist on plastic and non-porous surfaces for months together. Next point to remember about Candida auris is the fact that this species was identified first time in 2009 in Japan. Why is it the name auris? Because it was isolated from the ear of a patient. Right. Next important point is that Candida auris was misidentified. It was misidentified as by the automated systems. We have so many automated systems which are based on the assimilation and fermentation tests. So automated systems like Vitek, like Phoenix, etc. As other species of Candida, we don't have to remember their names. For example, Hemulonae. So it's a complex of Candida species, misidentified. But how can we differentiate Candida auris from the Candida hemulonae? One method is, unlike other species of Candida, it does not form pseudo hyphae, and it does not form true hyphae. So this is one method of differentiating it. Next is ability to grow at 42 degrees Celsius. The other species of Canada, leaving, we are not talking about Canada albicans, we're talking about how, what it is confused as. It grows at 42 or it grows at. It grows and the presence of 10% of salt concentration. Right? So this is the way we can differentiate it. But there are other more, even better methods which are MALDI-TOF. We can use PCR or we can use gene sequencing. All these methods can be used to differentiate Canada oris from the other species with, to which it is misidentified. And remember, Canada oris antifungal resistance is a huge, huge problem. It's a huge problem. More than 90% of isolates are resistant to fluconazole. 90% are resistant to fluconazole. But what are we going to remember? That if you find a person, if you have an outbreak of Candida auris in your hospital and you suspect that this patient may be a carrier, this healthcare worker may be a carrier of Candida auris on the skin, what you can do is use chlorhexidine for eradication of that carriage, right? Another chemical that you can use is povidone iodine. So both chlorhexidine and povidone iodine are effective against Candida auris. Next question, organism affecting the proximal intestines. Right, let's find out the answer. Shigella, this is primarily a colitis. Vibrio cholerae, the site of action is primarily the small intestines, especially the ileum. Enterohemorrhagic Escherichia coli is another colitis. Yersinia enterocolitica, the name itself is telling us this is another colitis. So what is our answer? By elimination, we have arrived at Vibrio cholerae. Mode of infection of guinea worm. So guinea worm, also called as Dracunculus medinensis. How do we get the infection? By ingestion of water. What is it containing? Cyclops. So this is the other host in the life cycle of Dracunculus. Water ingested, which is containing cyclops, and those cyclops are containing the larvae of Dracunculus. Mucor mycosis is associated with all except diabetes, hypertension, steroids, and deferoxamine therapy. The answer to this is hypertension. Remember, what are the risk factors for mucor mycosis? One is uncontrolled diabetes. Uncontrolled diabetes. Next risk factor is neutropenia. Then we have immunosuppression or immunosuppressive therapy for transplantation. Another risk factor is long-term steroids. And lastly, any state in which there is high levels of free iron in the patient's blood. Higher levels of free iron enhance the replication of the fungi causing mucor mycosis, rhizopus, mucor, etc. Right? So deferoxamine therapy is going to lead to this. So this is also a risk factor. Fibrosing mediastinitis is seen in infection with which of the following? Histoplasma, Streptococcus, Actinomyces, Haemophilus influenzae. The answer to this is Histoplasma. It's a very, very rare complication in fibrosing mediastinitis. All true about Staph aureus food poisoning. What did we learn about Staph aureus food poisoning? It's a preformed toxin. Incubation period is 1 to 5 hours through, mostly due to consumption of milk or related products. There are other products also associated, sometimes salads. Then vomiting, of course, is more severe in comparison to diarrhea. What is wrong? The thing is, the heat-stable toxins are not formed in the gut. They are preformed in the food. Which of the following is not a pyrogenic cytokine? Pyrogenic, so all of these are pyrogenic. Which are the pyrogenic cytokines we are going to remember? One is interleukin 1 alpha, interleukin 1 beta. Then we have TNF alpha, interleukin 6, and we have less important ciliary neurotrophic factor. These are the important cytokines causing fever. 1 alpha and beta, interleukin 6, TNF alpha. Right? So the answer to this question will be TGF beta, transforming growth factor beta. An ICU patient is being treated with clindamycin. He develops diarrhea and blood examination shows leukocytosis. So clindamycin, what are we going to think of? Antibiotic associated colitis, which is very characteristically associated with leukocytosis. What is the next ideal step? We are going to prove the infection or prove that this is the diagnosis is Clostridium difficile infection. So what are we going to do? We are going to carry out ELISA for detection of toxin A and toxin B of Clostridium difficile. Please note the name of Clostridium has now been changed to Clostridioides difficile. So it is now Clostridioides difficile. So we will do an ELISA directly on this stool. I'm sure there was another question on the same lines. It was the drug was being asked, what will you treat this patient with, a pseudomembranous colitis patient? The drug of choice nowadays, it is an update that all kinds of antibiotic associated colitis and pseudomembranous colitis, the drug of choice is oral vancomycin. This is the update. Even for mild disease, we are going to use vancomycin. Resistance, which is detected in the CBNAT. CBNAT, also called as the expert MTB RIF assay. Expert MTB RIF assay, what does it detect? One, it detects the presence of Mycobacterium tuberculosis in the specimen. And two, it detects the mutation in the RPOB gene. RPOB gene is responsible for resistance to rifampicin. So the answer is rifampicin only. An HIV positive patient, this I am not sure of the recall options, neither am I sure about the question. It was an HIV positive patient who had a painless erythematous rash on the neck and also on the heart palate. What is the likely cause? So an HIV patient with an erythematous rash on the neck, what am I going to think? Looking at the options, Epstein-Barr virus, does it cause a rash in HIV? No, it doesn't. CMV, neither does it cause. Human herpes virus, so, and herpes simplex. Herpes simplex is ruled out. Why? Because it is a painless, right? So what are we going to think of? This is likely to be Kaposi's sarcoma. And what is the cause of Kaposi's sarcoma? HHV-8, human herpes virus. So I would mark this as the answer. Right, so thank you very much. Hope you liked the discussion.